मॉर्निंग ऑल। मॉर्निंग ऑल, एम आई ऑडिबल? Yeah, fine. Hope you are good. I hope you guys are doing good. Let's start the verilog SDL. So we were discussing the module 1. In module 1 we saw the typical design flow, then the emergence of SDL, etc. in the previous class. So this is an important question for your exam point of view. Explain the typical design flow. Suppose okay, many are joining now. Please join as early as possible. Yeah, this was the things we were discussing in the previous class. If I want to design an IC or if I want to design any custom made electronic circuit, integrated circuit, then these are the steps to be followed. First, we have to go with this design specification. Design specification is a customer will come and give you. So this is my requirement. I want an IC to be doing the proper doing the functionalities like this. So it starts the design specification. Then the engineers will come into picture. That is, they'll write the behavioral description. So RTL description is how to achieve that functionality using logic cells. That is to be decided by RTL description. That is to be dealt in detail with RTL description. So this is to be nowadays we don't go for register transistor level of writing the codes, because it is taken care by the HTL. So at this point of time I'll stop and I'll just show you the Xilinx working. So Xilinx is a software that we are using in your lab. So you have a lab called as HDL lab. In that HDL lab you have the following so what we have to do is Verilog coding and VHDL coding is done by Xilinx, a company named Xilinx. We'll provide the software that is to be done using in your lab, Xilinx simulation tool. So you have this tool. So before starting the next part of the theory, I would like to share a video on Xilinx tutorial. So is it fine? So we shall watch a small video, then we can continue with the class. Just watch a small video. Yeah, you have a small video here. Just go with this video.
In Xilinx, you can also use the same steps to run a VHDL module. So let's go ahead and open the Project Navigator program.
So just
Go
watch
ahead
the
and
video.
close this tip of the day window. Go to File, New Project, and from here select your working directory and your location. Let's go ahead and give our project a name. Click Next. In this project settings window, you can specify settings for your FPGA. If you are planning to upload this code to an FPGA, what you want to do is learn VHDL or Verilog, or just simply test your modules. You don't have to worry about the settings. Go ahead and click Next and finish. Go ahead and on the left panel, right click on your project's name in the folder. So I'm going to right click example project, select new source. And from here, we can either choose a Verilog module or VHDL module. I'm gonna go ahead and select Verilog and give my module a name. Let's go ahead and make a three input OR gate. So I'm gonna name my module file accordingly. Make sure Add to Project is selected. Click Next. The use of this window is optional. It lets you set up the headers of your module, so like which variables you want them to be input, which do you want for output. Like I said, we're gonna have three different inputs. I'm gonna call this one I1, I2, and I3, one for each input. And I'm going to call my output gate output, and from the direction, I'm going to select output for that port name, gate output. Click Next, Finish.
Yeah. Listen here. Yeah. Listen here. At this point, I've stopped the program. So what we have done is we have just defined only the inputs and outputs. Are you able to follow, guys? Just reply me. Anybody reply me in the chat window. Are you guys able to follow? Hello, am I audible? Yeah, fine. If you just see the video there, we have just typed the inputs and outputs. So that's what is the basic step in writing a program. So once you write the inputs, once you declare the inputs and outputs, automatically the Verilog HDL will give us a black box view. You can see here, we have just defined the three input OR gate. We have named the module name. We have defined the inputs, we have defined the outputs. Then automatically a box has been come. Box means a structure, a program structure has come. What is the program structure? Program structure is like this. You have the keyword module. Any Verilog program will start with the keyword module, followed by module name, then the list, inputs and outputs. So we are trying to define a three input OR gate here. So that three input OR gate, inputs are declared as I1, I2, I3, and you can name it as for your convenience. You can name it ABC or you can give your own names, no problem. But you can see that the keywords are turned into blue color. So whatever program you write, if there is a keyword that will turn as blue colored letters. So you can observe here, this is the blue color letter indicates that it is a keyword. It is reserved in the Verilog. If anything which turns blue, you have to identify it as a keyword. Then a basic structure doesn't have the relationship between the inputs and outputs. So we have just defined the inputs and outputs, and you have a basic structure of the program like module and end module. Within that end module and end module, you have the module name. We have given the inputs, we have defined the outputs. So let's continue and see how it will work fine. How it works.
So the program has generated a basic module code. Let's create the OR gate with the three inputs. Now that our module is finished, let's go ahead and create a test bench or a text fixture as it is known in Verilog. Don't forget to save this by you doing Control S or by clicking this save button. So to create the stimulus file, right click on your folder name, new source, or Verilog. We're gonna need a test fixture. If you're doing VHDL, you need a test bench. So test fixture for Verilog, and I'm gonna call this file stimulus. Select add to project, click next. Now from here, if we had any other modules, we will be given the option of selecting those, but since we only have one, then that's the one we have to select, and click next and finish. So now Xilinx has generated this stimulus file with a time scale and some setup code. So notice that it has declared my inputs and my outputs using the same variable name that I used in my module, but of course in the stimulus file you can use a different name for those variables. It has also instantiated my three input OR gate module with the name UUT, and of course it has passed it all the inputs and outputs that it requires. It also initialized my inputs. So let's go ahead and add some stimulus to the module. So after 50 units of time, let's change input 1 to 1. After another 50, let's change it back to 0. And after 60, let's change input 3 to 1. Now let's go ahead and monitor the output. So this should take care of my stimulus file. Now to run this file, select simulation from this left panel. Select your stimulus file. Open this drop-down menu and double-click on simulate behavioral model. So this window should open and you're going to see the output from my monitoring statement in here. So for when all the inputs are zero, my output is zero. My output is one when at least one of the inputs is one, which will be in this case and also this case. And that is how you can simulate or test a Verilog or VHDL module inside Linux. Thank you for watching.
Hi.
Okay, just we have seen how to write the program and test bench. So you don't find any test bench code in your labs. Directly we'll simulate the outputs and see the output with the help of a simulator. We have an iSim simulator that waveforms will appear directly. So we need not write test bench code or a test bench code is not required in your lab, but usually this is what is the process that we follow in lab. So in lab, so first we will write the black box view. Black box view is nothing but basically we'll write a diagram. I'll show you. Wait, I'll show you. Yeah, one second, we'll show the sample code so that you'll come to understand what do you mean by that. Yeah. Yeah, this is what is the block diagram, basic block diagram. So I suggest my students to follow this basic first step. So suppose you write any complex program, the first step is to write the black box, a block diagram. So in this block diagram, you can see what are the inputs and what are the outputs. What are the inputs and what are the outputs is has to be declared at the beginning stage of the program. So here we have two inputs, A and B, and the outputs are we are trying to realize all the logic gates in one program. That is why we have to write all the outputs. So this is the basic step. One more program I'll show you. Yeah, you once if you want to write a 2-to-4 decoder. 2-to-4 decoder, you can see that a decoder is a logic circuit which will perform the reverse operation of encoding. Encoding means we'll try to reduce the number of bits. If it is a big data means if it is of 8 bits, we'll try to compress it into 3 bits. N to 2 power n. Sorry, 2 power n is to n is encoder, whereas decoder is n is to 2 power n. So here we have a 2-to-4 decoder. The inputs are 2 bits, the outputs are 4 bits. So you can see here, there is a D underscore N is the input. So 2 indicates that it's a 2 input, 2 inputs are there, D in 0, D in 1, like as I mentioned, the 2 table. Similarly, 4 inputs, 4 outputs are there, D underscore out, D output 3, 2, 1, 0. And we have an enable pin. So basically, if you want to write any program, we need to have the basic idea. What are the inputs and outputs? So now the screen is visible. Is the screen visible? Now check. Okay, leave it. Suppose One second, wait, I'll just open it in the Google tab only, okay? Join folder. One with wait one second, I'll just show you the screen. I'll show you. Chrome tab. Now is this okay? Are you able to follow? Is the screen visible now? Yeah, fine. Yeah, any program, you have to start with a basic block diagram. Why I insist on writing the block diagram is at the entry point only we'll come to know what are the inputs and outputs. Then the confusion will be less. If it is a complex program, any program will start with a keyword module, as I always say. In Verilog, a program will start with a keyword module followed by the input ports and output ports. So suppose that is the condition, basically we should write this properly first. Inputs, outputs. Suppose you see this example of a decoder, 2 to 4 decoder, D underscore in is the input and D underscore output is the output. So you have 2 inputs and 4 outputs. Basically, as a beginner, you have to follow this. First write the block diagram of the code, of any code, then followed by the actual coding. Definitely truth table should be known to you guys, because that's why the entire fundamental of this subject is Verilog, entire fundamental for this course is your DST, digital system design. So you should thoroughly study that DST, then only you will be able to follow this STL in a proper way. Fine. And so this is also one more block diagram, 8 to 3 priority encoder. 8 is the number of input bits, starting from A in 0 to A in 7, and 3 outputs, Y output 1 to 0 to 2, 0, 1, 2, 3 outputs will be there. As I always say, every block diagram will have this, every code will have this block diagram. All my coding, so this is the manual I prepared for your lab. I'll just share with you guys, if you have, if anybody gives me your mail ID in the chat window, I'll just forward it to you, so you can forward it to your class. Anyone can ping me your mail ID in the chat window, same chat window, just follow the, you put your mail ID so that I can forward this HDL lab manual. Is anybody? Bargo, put your mail ID. Okay, in the classroom itself, I can share. Okay, fine. Oh, no problem. Okay, I'll share it in the classroom now. Yes, sir. Okay, just posted an assignment, just go through it. Okay, in the classwork, I have created a classwork and you have to write the program for all 7 gates and scan it and upload. You can refer my Verilog manual, HDL lab manual. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. So we'll continue with the actual syllabus now. So this is about your lab. Just go through the lab and don't worry, it's very easy. It's very easy lab. You can definitely learn well and excel in a Verilog HDL. Okay, no need to have hesitation. You can definitely do well in your HDL lab. HDL lab is very simple. Only thing is you need to have interest in LD. Fine. So the hierarchical modeling concepts was this was a thing that we have done in your previous lab. So there are two basic types of digital design methodologies. Designer must use a good design methodology to do efficient Verilog HDL based design. The designer must be able to follow this rule, simple basic rule. Either we have to use basic two types of digital design methodologies. First one is the top down design methodology, and the other thing is the bottom up design methodology. So either I can use top down design methodology or bottom up design methodology. So you can just visualize these two methodologies as building the house from RCC to foundation, or the ulta, foundation to RCC. So now ellaru RCC inda, sorry, foundation inda RCC hogtivi, RCC inda idakke barala. But we have this option in digital design. Either we can start with the top down design methodology, or we can go with the bottom up design methodology. Let us try to define it. In top down design methodology, we can define a top level block and identify the sub blocks necessary to build the top level block. So top level block is first created in the top down design methodology, then sub blocks are identified and then they are built, and sub blocks are further divided into leaf cells. These sub blocks are divided into further leaf cells. You can look at the arrow now. The arrow mark signifies that the design is top down. From the top level block, we are trying to design the sub block. From the sub block, we are trying to define the leaf cells. So this is how the design methodology works. Top down design methodology. In a bottom up design methodology, designer identifies the basic building blocks which are necessary for the higher level. For the higher level, which is necessary, basically we start from the leaf cell. From the leaf cells, we start with the macro cells. From the macro cell, we'll go with the top level block. So usually there are two design methodologies. So this is building house from foundation to RCC. This is ulta, from RCC we will come back. But this is not possible in practical scenario. But here in HTL, we can follow any of the two design methodologies. It can be top level design methodology or bottom up approach. Bottom up approach. So usually there is a combination of top down and bottom up flows is used. Either it is your designer choice. Designer can use either a top down or bottom up methodology. However, in whichever possible way, which is best to you guys, you can use it. Design architects define specifications of the top level block. Logic designers decide how the design should be structured by breaking up the functionality into blocks and sub blocks. So it is done in a combinational way nowadays. Example, you have a 4-bit triple carry counter. So this 4-bit triple carry counter, the block diagram is like this. So this is the module triple carry counter. Look at the inputs now. The inputs are clock, reset. What are the outputs? Q0, Q1, Q2, Q3. If you write the block diagram or the code, module ripple carry counter, input clock comma reset, output Q0, Q1, Q2, Q3. How this Q0 is taken? Q0 is taken by T flip flop. T flip flop, again T flip flop. Four T flip flops are employed here for 4-bit ripple carry counter. The ripple carry counter is made up of negative edge trigger T flip flops, and each T flip flop is made up of D flip flops and inverters. So this is how the T flip flop is achieved. Just by connecting an inverter from the output to the input, it becomes your T flip flop. So now look at the, which is the leaf cell now. Leaf cell is the inverter and the D flip flop. From the leaf cell, we are trying to define the. So if you just look at the methodology, so ripple carry counter is the top level block. T flip flop is the sub block, and inverter and the D flip flop are the leaf cells. Leaf cells. So this is the top down design methodology. If I follow the bottom up design methodology, first I'll write the inverter, then I'll write the D flip flop, then I'll write the program for T flip flop. From the four T flip flops, I'll write the ripple carry counter. So this is an example of design methodology. So you can see here, I have not put any arrows here. The arrows is left to you guys. If it is bottom top up top down methodology, the arrow mark will be like this, downwards arrow. If it is ulta, it will be like this. So this is an hierarchy. You can either follow any of the following hierarchies. Okay, is that clear? If you have any doubts, you can unmute and ask me doubts. All of you watch cricket, right? Definitely yes. If a bouncer is there, either you can hit six or you can bend the batsman will bend. If you are getting, you feel that fine, it is going inside your head, or if you're not getting, it is bouncer. Choice is yours. Okay, try to follow my teaching. If you have any doubts, please don't hesitate to ask. If you feel hesitate to ask here, you can call me or you can WhatsApp me, and I am able to help. Able to help you guys. Just follow. I know it is tough to follow in online classes, but there is no way. You have to learn like this only till the further instructions. So try to cope up with the learning methodology. I know it is very hard to understand and it's very hard to remember what we'll teach in online, because we are just becoming a screen watchers. That's it. Online class, yeah, we'll just watch the screen, hear the audio, that's it. No physical presentation or physical appearance will be there, no eye contact, no body language like this. So we cannot judge everybody. So make sure that you learn well in this situation. Do not panic. If you have any doubts, please ask me. Okay, no doubts. We'll end the class now. Put your attendance, mark your attendance, and then you can leave. This you will do within an instant of time. You will do within no time. We'll be typing your attendance. Okay, fine. Thank you. You can leave the class as soon as you mark the attendance. Okay. If you leave, okay, all of lover day and all. If you leave, I'll just close the class. Okay, I will stop here. We'll meet in the next class. Thank you.